your spirit to breathe. Though in might and power and purpose I'll see my life restored, now I hear revival begin. I can face this world, now in Christ is the hope to fulfill his goal. I will shout from the solid rock, deep in my soul. You are my rock, my rock eternal. You are my source and inspiration.
We hope this finds you well. We say that every week because actually our prayer is that in these days when actually it would be so easy to give up, to not want to get out of bed, that you are well, that you are understanding, that you are loved by God our Creator, that you recognize that the Holy Spirit is drawing close to you because of the work that Jesus did on the cross that makes us able to come in to God's presence. We commence our worship by singing one of the songs, a Salvation Army song from one of the musicals that says, "He came to give us life in all its fullness." You know, friends, in this last year, I wondered if we settled for second best, not out of choice, but based on circumstance. And yet God invites us to live in the abundant life, the full life. John 10:10, Jesus says, "I come that you may have life and have it in all its fullness." So as we celebrate the life that Jesus gives, may we step into that life and learn to live in worship, in praise of our God. He came to give us life in all its fullness. Let's sing together.
To smile. He came to bind the broken hearted and God and man to reconcile. He came to give us light in all his fullness. He came to make the blind to see. He came to banish death and death and darkness. He came to set his people free.
We wonder why Christ came into the world.
We wonder why they tolerated.
This week I was speaking to somebody that said, you know, John, sometimes prayer has become really difficult because I pray that COVID would disappear, I pray that so-and-so would live, I pray that this would happen, the next thing would happen, and it just feels that God has distanced himself from me. Friends, I want to tell you that God has not distanced himself from us. Just because we don't feel it doesn't mean to say it's not true. And so I invite you, as we come in prayer this morning, to focus your mind, your heart, on our Creator, who loves us, who cares for us, who wants to touch us with his presence. As we listen to the music and read the prayer, let's come into God's presence, acknowledge that he is here, and that he is speaking and listening and waiting to receive our hearts and our prayers at this time. So let's pray together.
God's story, Lazarus. So part of God's story is about how Jesus brought a man back to life, and it goes like this. Jesus had three really good friends, Mary, Martha, and their brother Lazarus. One day, Lazarus got really sick. He was so sick that he might die. Mary and Martha knew the only one who could heal Lazarus was Jesus, so they sent someone to find him. They found Jesus traveling and telling people about God. Now, you might think that Jesus would rush to heal his friend, But instead of leaving right away, Jesus stayed where he was for 2 more days. See, Jesus knew something no one else knew. Lazarus had died, but Jesus was going to bring him back to life so that they would believe that Jesus really was the Son of God. When Jesus finally got to Lazarus's house, Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. Mary and Martha were heartbroken. Martha said, "Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha didn't understand at first. What Jesus meant was that he would actually bring Lazarus back to life here on earth. Jesus was saying, because he's the Son of God, he's more powerful than death. After that, Martha's sister Mary ran to Jesus and fell at his feet. "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her crying, he was so sad. In fact, when Jesus came to the tomb where Lazarus was buried, he cried too. His friend, who he loved so much, was dead. Kids, have you ever felt sad because of something that happened to you or someone you cared about? Just like us, Jesus felt pain and sadness because of what happened to his friend. Then Jesus told some people to roll away the big, heavy stone in front of the tomb. He looked up and prayed, "Father, I know that you always hear me." Then he called out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" And then Lazarus walked out. This man who had been dead for 4 days was now standing in front of everyone, walking and talking and alive. The people were amazed. You see, Jesus knew all along that he could bring Lazarus back to life. Jesus wanted people to see who he was, the Son of God. He wanted people to see God's greatness, that God could do anything, even bring someone back from the dead. And Jesus was about to do something even more incredible. He himself was about to die for us, be buried in a tomb for 3 days, and then come back to life. And he did it to rescue us from all of our pain, sadness, and wrong choices. And when we believe in him, we get to be a part of God's family forever. And that's the story of Lazarus. So, in case you missed it, here's the quick version. Jesus' friend Lazarus got sick. Lazarus died. His sisters were really sad. Jesus was sad too. Jesus brought Lazarus back to life. Later, Jesus died. He came back to life too. And he was able to do it all because he's God's son. And that's a part of God's story.
We all have those pictures that we look at in our house of what it used to be like, how we used to look, how big or how small our body used to be. I wonder if we've got the same image in our mind when it comes to our salvation story, our before and our after picture of God's work in our life. I want you to ponder that for a moment as we sing that song, "When I Was Lost, You Came and Rescued Me." This morning we're thinking about giving up to get up, that God, through Jesus, lifts us up to a new way of living. And we sing and thank God for the fact that in our lostness, he lifts us up and brings us into a new life in him. So let's sing, but also ponder that question. What does my before and after picture look like?
Thank you. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him. But Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died, but I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she replied. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come into the world. After she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. The teacher is here, she said, and is asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, see how he loved him. But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth round his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go.
In these days of COVID-19, I guess we all wake up in the morning and think, what can I do today? And then we go, oh, we can't do anything. And you might be like me some days and want to pull the duvet back up over your face and snuggle in and think, I give up. There's nothing I can do. My usual routines have all gone haywire. Life is a bit rubbish. And yet actually there's Lent time, we've been inviting you to come and think about, I give up, and changing the tone and saying, I give up, I'm going to look up and fulfill God's plan and purposes and will for my life. I'm going to worship Him in spirit and truth. I'm going to focus on Jesus and allow the 6 or 7 weeks to change me from the inside out, to transform me into who I am and who I should be in Christ. This morning the title is Giving Up to Get Up. Giving up to get up. You see, when we look at the stories in Scripture, we realize that Jesus invites you and I to come follow Him. And when He says, come follow Him, He's saying, come follow me and I will take you into a new abundant life. That day when we surrendered our life to Jesus, we committed to a new way of being. But if I've been honest, in our faith, often we pull the doobie up and go, I give up. I remember 20 years or so ago, more than that now, when I answered the call to God to be a Salvation Army officer. I went through the process, I attended all the different things, and then I went to assessment. I got the news that I'd been an accepted candidate to go into training in the next academic year, and then I decided that it wasn't for me, so I would apply for another job. And if I got the job, my logic was I had misunderstood God the first time round. Now remember, the process to becoming an officer isn't simple. It's quite complicated. There's lots of things you need to do to even get anywhere near William Booth College. And in that process, I had accepted God's call. But my selfishness, my humanness kicked in, and I thought maybe, hopefully, there was a second plan, a B road, if you like. Well, after getting the job and then realizing that it would have been a comfortable, happy job, actually I would not be fulfilling God's plan and purposes for my life. And I was being called to something greater. Jesus was saying, I want to take you on an adventure in your life. For me, that was officership. Of course, for you, that might be something different. Sometimes we need to give up our will and our plans and purposes that we might live in the abundant, fruitful life that God's plans. The big idea this morning is I give up my life to live in abundant life with Christ. I give up my life, my will, my wants, my agenda, that I might live in the abundant life with Christ. You see, they're both incompatible. We can't be doing our own thing and still following Jesus, because actually that's disobedience. We've got to follow His plans and His will and His purposes in our lives. C.S. Lewis says this, for He claims all because He is love and He must bless. He cannot bless us unless He has us. When we try to keep within us an area that is our own, we try to keep an area of death, the life that leads to death. Therefore, in love, He claims all. There's no bargaining with God. We've got to give up all that we might gain up. From a level of playing field to the abundant life, the new elevated life that God calls us in our life, in our holiness, in a salvation, in abundance. That abundant life is fruitful, is great. Now, is it always comfortable? Is it always full of provision in a different way? Yes, but not how maybe we would expect it. But we must give up that we might gain up to that abundant life. Matthew 16:25, Jesus says, if you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it. I would argue, he's saying, you will save it, you won't die. It's more than that, you will live in the abundant life here. And so we turn to John chapter 11, and we use it this morning to teach us some truths about how we move from living in a boring, monotonous life into the abundant, Jesus-centered life. We're looking at the story of Lazarus. Lazarus, of course, means whom God helps. Whom God helps. There's a few commands that Jesus does in this narrative of Jesus calling Lazarus out of the grave, who had already died, by the way. He calls him out of the grave. And those commands are words, four words that will speak to us and help us learn to move beyond the mundane and into the abundant life God has got for us. I wonder, do we live the dead Lazarus life in the tomb, or are we willing to be a person who says, John, Eileen, Mike, Ian, put your name in there, is someone whom God helps, because they live in the life that God has set before them. So giving up our lives to receive life means we need to, number one, remove those things that block the abundant life. Look at John 11:39a. Jesus says, roll the stone aside. P- push it aside. He's speaking to the crowd, move the stone aside. Now, it's interesting that he didn't do it himself. He is God, after all. He gets other people involved. I'm not going to pursue that line of thinking, but of course we recognize that we grow in the abundant life with each other, in family and in community. But Jesus says, roll the stone aside. The stone was the one thing that stood between Jesus and Lazarus. It separated them. It was keeping Jesus from being nearer to Lazarus, and it was keeping Lazarus from being nearer to Jesus. The stone blocked the relationship. I wonder what stands between Jesus and yourself and myself when it comes to living the abundant life. Perhaps it's sin. Now, sin is anything that we do that's our agenda, our plan, our purpose that glorifies me rather than puts Jesus first. Sin is that thing that is offensive to God rather than actually blesses his name and lifts his name up. Sin is quite a generic term because we would name it, wouldn't we, when we come in repentance. But actually, anything that says that we are first and God is not, ultimately is sin. I love what Tim Keller says. He says, the gospel is this: we are more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dared believe. Yet at the very same time, we are more loved and accepted in Jesus Christ than we ever dared hope. Friends, the stone that is sin, that is blocking us in a relationship with Jesus, can be removed because Jesus paid the price on the cross. The blood was shed that we might remove the stone of sin and live in the abundant life. Perhaps it's not so much sin, but personal wants. Now remember, if a personal want puts Jesus secondary to our agenda, then it's sin ultimately. But personal wants might be relationships. We put them before God. What about our job? I'm too busy to be involved in Christian community and give my time in worship to God because I've got something to do. It might be a hobby. I spoke to somebody recently and said, I've never been a church goer because I like to go out on a Sunday morning and do my shopping and grab a coffee. Might be the schedule. I'm much too busy and my diary is my life. Voskamp says this: our four walls, and always has been and always will be, that we aren't satisfied in God and what he gives. We hunger for something more, something other than ultimately relationship with him. So sin can be the stone, personal wants can be the stone, community can be the stone. We listen to family, we listen to friends, we listen to church, we listen to society, we listen to our close ally in the world. And like Martha, they come in verse 39b. Martha, the dead man's sister, protested Jesus and says, Lord, he was been dead for 4 days. He's going to stink. It'll be terrible. And Jesus rebukes her, and we'll come to that in a moment. But actually, sometimes we listen to the voices in our mind that tells us, actually, don't follow God, don't follow his plan, and they become stones in our relationship. We're either obedient or disobedient. We've got to be careful that we don't allow the community of people in our lives to affect our relationship with God. There's a Chinese proverb that says, the person who says it cannot be done should not interrupt the person who is doing it. Don't allow a voice out there telling you not to follow God's plan to affect your whole eternal life, because actually you are stepping out in faith. In verse 40, Jesus responds to Martha and says, didn't I tell you that you would see God's glory if you believe? She had accepted the death. She needed to remove the lack of faith and step into the abundant life that God was going to give by giving her brother back. Giving up our lives to receive life means we need to remove the stones, those blockages. Respond to the call of God. Look at verse 43 and 44. Then Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come out! And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound in grave clothes, his face wrapped in a head cloth. Lazarus had died. I think we often miss the fact that if you look at verse 42, that actually Jesus had prayed a public prayer, and he declares, I'm praying this prayer because I want them to hear God. I'm speaking to you. I'm putting you first. You know, before we hear the calling of God to follow and the invitation to come, we've got to recognize he commences with prayer. When Jesus says, remove the stone, come follow me, we need to repent of the stuff that blocks that path. We need to recognize and give recognition to the fact that he is the Son of God. And we need to recognize that our empowerment for the future, our regeneration, comes from acknowledging God for who he is and putting him first in our life. Jesus had to call out Lazarus by name, for if he hadn't, all the dead would have come out of their graves, says Augustine. Isn't it true that he had the power? This is God here, calling out Lazarus to come alive. You see, it's not good enough to only hear Jesus. We've got to be obedient. And now Lazarus didn't just hear the voice of God shouting, come out. He follows through in obedience. Lazarus is commanded to do something no one else in history had been told to do. Sometimes we need to recognize that God might call us to respond to the call, to come follow him, and that could take us all over the place. It might not make a lot of sense at the time, but if we trust in God and in his words and his plan and his purpose, and we step out in obedience, we learn to live in the abundant life he set before us. You see, we go from darkness to light, we go from death to life, from sinful to spiritual. Christ is calling us. But we must respond and follow. And when we respond to the calling of God, we find ultimate release. Verse 44 in John 11. And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound in grave clothes, his face wrapped in a headcloth. Jesus told them, unwrap him and let him go. A miracle took place, but Lazarus was still limited. Many of us have had great experiences of the Son of God, that is Jesus, but today we are limited by the things that we get so wrapped up in. I wonder what the thing is that you're wrapped up in. Is it sin? Is it intimidation? Is it others' opinions? I hope they like me. Is it worry that it might not go to plan? We need to allow the Lord to release those limitations, because our God is greater, our God is stronger than any other, and he can do much more in our lives. John 8:38, if the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. You're truly free. You can be released to be all that you can be. Let's never allow religiosity or those things that we wrap ourselves up in to become not only something that is a nice idea, but a binding mechanism for us to live the abundant life. So we giving up our lives to receive life means we need to remove the stones, those things that cause us not to focus in God, respond to the call to come follow, to release the junk and allow Jesus to work in us, and then allow God to reveal himself through us. Verse 45, many of the people who were with Mary believed in Jesus when they saw this happen. And then jump to John 12, verse 9 to 11. When all the people heard of Jesus' arrival, they flocked to see him and also to see Lazarus, the man Jesus had raised from the dead. Notice this. Then the leading priests decided to kill Lazarus too, for it was because of him that many of the people had deserted them and believed in Jesus. Lazarus had never said a word. His life, the fact that he was living the abundant, resurrected life in Jesus, was a witness and pointed people to the Christ. I wonder if our lives point people to Jesus. Our experiences show that Jesus is alive and well in us. St. Francis of Assisi says that at all times preach the gospel, and when necessary, use words. Giving up our earthly mundane lives to receive abundant life means that we remove the blockages. We respond to the call to follow. We release the baggage and the religiosity, and we become vessels that reveal the glory of God to our world. I wonder what experience you need this morning to enter into a true abundant life. Do you need to remove something between you and Jesus? Do you need to respond to the command of Jesus to come follow him? Do you need to be released from something that is limiting you in your walk to abundance? Do you need to reveal to others what God has done for you by living it out in your world? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that you call us to come follow you, and you invite us to give up all that we might get up out of this mundane, long, dragged out life and learn to live the abundant life. I pray for each of us this day, Father God, that you will do a work in our hearts and in our minds, that you will transform our thinking, and that you will elevate us to a new way of being because of the work of Jesus on the cross. Jesus, move in our lives, we pray. Amen. Amen. We're going to listen and sing along to that little old chorus, Lord, make Calvary real to me. And as you sing, I wonder, do you need to remove? Do you need to respond? Do you need to release? Do you need to ask God who you must reveal his glory? Let's worship and pray together. Good morning and God bless.